Freiheit ist das Recht, anderen zu sagen, was sie nicht hören wollen.
Sinngemäß
hat das mal George Orwell in einem Buch so geschrieben.
Oder
man könnte in Deutschland auch sagen, keep calm and go to Karlsruhe.
You could also say, keep calm, go to Karlsruhe.
Die Gesellschaft für Freiheitsrechte wird in den nächsten Talk vorgestellt. Es werden zwei Leute diesen Talk machen. Das eine ist der Ulf Burmeier, der ist Richter in Berlin, wissenschaftlicher Mitarbeiter am Verfassungsgericht in Berlin. Er macht einen Podcast, Lage der Nation. Er ist Philipp Banse, einem Journalisten, der so das aktuelle
politische Tagesgeschehen bewertet.
Er ist auch aktiv im Bereich Netzpolitik, bei der digitalen Gesellschaft, ist Jurist.
He is also with the digital society.
Was Sinn macht für die GFF.
Yeah.
Und er macht das zusammen mit Nora Markart. Nora Markart ist auch Juristin. Sie ist im Vorstand der GFF. Sie ist
Nora
Professorin
Markart
in Hamburg
will also
und setzt sich unter anderem auch für Flüchtlingsrechte ein. Zusammen machen sie beide recht viel. Sie machen auch zusammen unter anderem mit Malte Spitz noch die Gesellschaft für Freiheitsrechte.
But there
was sie
other
tun, warum sie es tun
them,
und was
example,
da alles so in 2019 zu erwarten ist.
Today they will
und
talk
was das
about
so als Ausblick
do,
für 2019 ansteht.
And,
das werden sie uns jetzt alles erzählen. Bitte nochmal einen Riesenapplaus für Nora und Ulf.
Now, please applause for Nora and Ulf.
Ja, hi. Vielen Dank, Konstantin, für die Einführung.
Hello, thank you for this introduction. We're here about Freedom Needs Fighters.
Und werden euch das Konzept strategische Prozessführung vorstellen.
We present you the concept of strategic process management.
Freiheitsrechte verteidigt werden müssen, auch
we want to defend the civil rights, also in the digital space.
Ich bin im Vorstand der Gesellschaft für Freiheitsrechte und neben mir steht.
Ich bin Ulf Burmeier. Hallo, herzlich willkommen zu unserem Talk.
I am the
wir freuen uns sehr, dass Sie alle hier
Chairman
sind.
Of
uns zunächst ein bisschen zuhört, aber
GFF. We want to discuss afterwards with you. So we will talk about for 45 minutes and then we can go into a discussion and wait for your input. Freedom is in danger. Our country is more or less a place where it's working quite well. But we have not only problems with Putin, we have also freedom in danger in Germany. And especially where the digital world is concerned.
Ja, genau. Die große Koalition sorgt im Grunde seit Jahren.
The big coalition is always passing new laws where they infringe the freedom rights, because in the political process there is nobody who is looking after it. In our talk, we would like to show where are the problems, where are the issues. We will not go frustrated. We want also to show what are the solutions, how can we act against these things and protect the civil rights and human rights.
Wir schreiben also schön, keep calm and go to Karlsruhe. Wir wollen natürlich überhaupt nicht, dass ihr calm bleibt.
We don't want that you keep calm. We think you can also be very furious, but sometimes you have to file suits. That's why GFF is here.
Wir haben euch jetzt mal so ein paar Highlights aus den Themenbereichen.
We will show you some highlights from the issues we are dealing with. For example, Trojans, mass surveillance, freedom of press, information, freedom of information, and so on. So the endangering of freedom of press, for example, there was the ban of leftist portal, Links und Intimedia. We think this is very bad for freedom of press. In our constitution, there is censor is forbidden. Should be, but sometimes you can be made liable. But there is no censorship beforehand. And in this case, you can ask: is this okay in the case of Intimedia? So they banned the whole site, so it was not a liability for one special part, but the whole site was forbidden. So they didn't forbid the press, the press publication, but they are going against the people who are behind in the media.
Kann man da nicht irgendwas konstruieren?
So they make a construction. So basically there is no law to ban any media. And the lender could do it, but they also have not the right to do it. So they circumvented it. They said the people behind Intimedia, they are an association, even if they didn't know that they are an association. And the Ministry of Interior said, you are an association, and then the clue is, you can forbid an association. So the association was forbidden, so they couldn't operate the website, which is the media. We think this is, from a legal point of view, absolutely unacceptable. So they misused the association code to forbid media. It's also very dangerous for democracy, because this would be that the parliament should be in charge of doing this and not a ministry. So you see how the civil rights are endangered. Another example is Twitter accounts. So, of course, the Twitter accounts are often very sharp against the state also. And authorities are also using Twitter, so they can be attacked on Twitter also. So you have, for example, police authorities who are making press work via Twitter. And sometimes, where there's a critical feedback, so if the same person is always critical against the authority, then what do you? Yeah, you're blocking them.
Yes, you're blocking the... You press the block button, but the problem is that if you block journalists or people, that they don't really have the opportunity to do anything against it. So you limit their possibilities to inform themselves, and you can also limit press freedom by that. And is there security for information freedom? And yes, there is. There is in our constitution. You can actually file a charge against the authorities who banned you. And there is a form for that, and you can ask them to say why they've banned you. And that usually works, actually, because normally they don't know what to write. Yeah, you can find such things at informationsfreiheit.org. One letter is enough. But there are other problems for freedom of information. That means that you don't only can look like on the account, but you can also write to them what are you doing actually. You can ask the state what they are doing. You can pose official questions to the state. And this is not really a thing that many places like, but you can actually do, and you can go to the court if they don't answer you.
Da muss man sich vielleicht noch ein bisschen vor Augen führen, dass so Behörden ja zur Exekutive gehören.
Authorities are part of the executive, and they are elected.
Ins Amt gesetzt, und da die Gewalt, alle Staatsgewalt geht ja vom Volke aus, das heißt auch
and the highest authority should be the people, and they are also the people who is paying the authorities and the government,
das Arbeiten einer Behörde finanziert.
If we all pay taxes for their work, then the authorities should be held accountable for what they are doing.
Zum Beispiel an Landesverteidigung, ja, bei der Bundeswehr gibt es sicherlich
for example, there are several parts where there is not working in defense. I think it's a long process to go through it. We want to, sometimes we have to go before court, then you have the dangers for whistleblowers. So people who are publishing things which are kept secret, for example, information about companies who are doing things which are not okay. Sometimes even illegal, a huge mess, nobody knows it, and these whistleblowers, they can leak, for example, some documents so that there is a public discussion about what's happening. And so the state can be active, make a new law, new regulations, or the police can act against it. The issue is that there is a huge legal risk for a whistleblower. If you are working for the state, then it's even a penal law against it. But even if you are working in a private company, this can be divulging secrets, which is also not allowed. So we want to protect the whistleblowers. Even for journalists, there is very few protections, and so they are endangered. Data fencing is also something punished by law. So this means that for journalists, they might be looked at as fencers of data. Basically, it's going against using stolen data.
Der Grundgedanke ist aber eigentlich ganz plausibel. Der Grundgedanke ist nämlich, man möchte nicht, dass gestohlene Kreditkarten.
The idea of this law was basically that, for example, credit card data are not divulged. But the law says just any kind of data can be fenced. Even whistleblowers, they are acting illegally, even if it's legitimate what they are doing.
Von Whistleblowern weitergegebene Daten.
So data coming from a whistleblower could be data fencing, and as a journalist, you can be punished if you are using it.
Kann man sich vorstellen, ist ausgesprochen gefährlich.
This is quite dangerous for the freedom of press, of course. And even experts, which are asked by a journalist for analysis of data, are under danger. For example, IT experts who are analyzing data sets of mails, inbox of Outlook, for example. For example, if you want to look if it's authentic. As a journalist, you will ask an expert to authenticate, for example, some data. For example, an expert from CCC, and even this expert could be a data fencer if this inbox was leaked.
CCC-Umfeld strafbar machen wegen Datenhehlerei, einfach weil es sich ja in Anführungsstrichen gestohlene Daten handelt. Also man kann sofort erkennen,
so even these experts could be charged if they actually have looked at those data because it could have been stolen. And that is a huge problem for press freedom. Yes, here we have a case of whistleblowing, of data fencing, a very new case. It's Hermann Theisen. He is an activist who is acting against illegal weapon exports. He is asking to whistleblow about illegal weapon exports. Is this a legal problem? Yes, It is, at least in the mind of some of the government people. Even if this is a person who is actually wanting to hinder something legitimate as concern as companies selling weapons into areas of crisis, and now he is facing charges, and it's why whistleblowing actually shouldn't be a criminal act.
Jetzt haben wir ja auch ein bisschen schon über so Überwachungsmaßnahmen.
We talked about surveillance. There was a lot from the big coalition.
Bunter Strauß von neuen Überwachungsmaßnahmen.
A lot of new measures.
Synthetische Palme vor dem Hauptquartier.
This is the synthetic palm before the Secret Service in Berlin.
Die haben es richtig nett.
Very nice in the night.
Ja, also reformiert wurden das G10, das the, Gesetz zu Artikel 10.
The G10 article was reformed. Then the Federal Police and the Secret Service Police law was changed.
Was Edward Snowden über die Arbeit der NSA oder der
So basically they would try to show that they would make possible what already the American and the British Secret Service are doing.
Sondern es geht darum, den ganz großen Schnorchel anzusetzen.
Es geht,
zum Beispiel, das ist in Deutschland das relevanteste,
it is,
also bei dem Internetknotenpunkt in Frankfurt, wo also
the goal is to attack the knots of the internet and to have the possibility to catch everything which is flowing through these networks and then to control it and surveil it.
Für unsere westlichen Demokratien. Das hat die große Koalition vor zwei, drei Jahren.
What Snowden did, I think, as a warning, is now more or less the plan that the German government is following.
Ungerichtete, massenhafte Internetüberwachung im Ausland.
Ja, gibt es da so eine rechtliche Grundlage?
Is there a legal base?
Also man kann da eine ganze Reihe von Freiheitsrechten denken.
A lot of civil rights are concerned. Of course, the freedom of the press is in danger because you cannot communicate on the internet without being sure to be overheard. And then goes into the data storage of the Secret Service, which of course is collaborating with other Secret Service from other countries. We are a state of law, but you never know where these data are flowing. Even our Secret Service doesn't know where all this data can go and flow. It's an issue for the freedom of the press, but also for the secret of communication secret. Basically, you should be able to communicate securely over distance as you can with somebody who is just sitting beneath you. That's the idea of the communication secret. So to guarantee confidentiality over distance. And honestly, I think the Secret Service has just abolished this right more or less with his capabilities and possibilities to suck everything out of these data networks. A lot of storage is also done. All these metadata are storaged. There is a special law for the Secret Service, which also is used. It's not nice. We think this is a law against that we have to act.
Machen Sie sich keine Sorgen.
Ja, machen Sie sich keine Sorgen, hieß es auch, als damals die biometrischen Passbilder eingeführt wurden.
So for example, when the biometric pass pictures were introduced, you even have allowed to smile. Many people had a problem, issues with the data protection. And it was told nothing would be used, everything is secure.
Was sollen wir machen? Der Ami will das so.
Because we did it because the Americans wanted it. But there is nothing to do. Surprise, surprise. Of course. There are people interested for these pictures. In summer 2017, a new law went into force, which allows different Secret Service, without any cause, to go to them and to use them. So they are stored by the authorities, and the Secret Service can suck them out.
So
this is like a self-service for the Secret Service. Of course, you have a combination. You are forced to have this document stored by the authority, and then the Secret Service can go onto it.
So
even if you have to store these pictures, it cannot be that the Secret Service is allowed to just pick them out. But the trouble is, when the data are here, then always there is somebody who wants to have them. For example, the new census for 2021 is planned. This is not a problem in itself. There are no rules yet. But of course, such a census needs a complex IT system. And of course, these systems must be secured, must be tested. And the Ministry of Interior thought, okay, we just use all the data we have just to test it. Some weeks ago, there was a law through the parliament who allowed this testing of the Census 2021, which will already begin in 2019. So the data of everybody, every people in Germany will be used for testing the new census IT.
Über sämtliche in Deutschland gemeldeten Personen weitergemeldet werden.
Und sind die Datensätze so anonymisiert? Und so?
And the data anonymized? Oh, no. These are real data because the IT system cannot be used otherwise.
Daten nach einem standardisierten
Verfahren. So the parliament was asked if we could anonymize it.
Namen, Geburtsort, Geburtsdatum nach einem bestimmten Standard
with hashtags. But they said this is too expensive.
Wenn wir das nämlich machen würden mit den Hashes, dann müsste ja jede Meldebehörde für ihre gemeldeten Menschen so einen Hash berechnen.
So every authority has to calculate her own hash. So they thought we put all the real data together, but don't. Yeah, we will clear them as soon as we have used them.
Ja, es ist auch einiges auf Landesebene los gewesen, ne?
Also there has been much on federal state level as well. Many have heard about Bavaria. There is a new police law, the BIPAC, Polizeiaufgabenrecht. It's a really big law. Usually there is federal police and federal state police and not one for whole Germany. You have heard much. Yeah, we have heard much about the Bavarian law. One topic was the government Trojan. This Trojan can actually hack into computer people. If there is, you can use it preventively if the authorities think you might do a crime. And this preventive measures can be taken much, much in advance. So to prevent terrorist actions, even if only a small group of people is meeting, this could actually be a problem, and this Trojan could be sent to them. That's what police authorities say, because that could pose a danger.
And Dutzende von Behörden in ganz Deutschland, also Geheimdienste,
that would mean that different authorities, police, but also other official authorities of Germany can hack into smartphones, mobiles of people. I don't want to go too far into how far this could reach, but maybe later we can do it in a short way. But yeah, at first we want just to post this keyword government Trojan. Another important keyword is preventive. Preventive captation.
Kann dann tätig werden, wenn es nicht Gefahren für die Sicherheit oder Ordnung gibt.
If it seems like there is danger for the public, or if something is a building could collapse, that's a danger. And now also a person can be a danger. Is this a person who could be concrete? Is there is concrete danger from it? But no, this it's quite complicated. You can't really say I'm not a danger. It's like this word of danger. It's very very.
Etwas Gefährliches passiert und wie gesagt gerade besonders schick bei den neu geschaffenen Polizeigesetzen.
In the new police laws, you have the preventive keeping of people, preventive arrest. So sometimes you could arrest the people for a very short time. And today there is much more time in the police law where you can use it. So even if the people hasn't done anything, you can keep them in arrest for quite a long time. In Bavaria, they are especially keen of this new right and possibility. So how can you prove that you are not a dangerous person? And if you are in arrest, then of course you are not dangerous. But as soon as you are out of it, you could be dangerous some way.
Genutzt werden. In Bayern wird ein Fall berichtet, wo Geflüchtete in einer
in Bavaria demonstriert haben und so eine Art an asylum seeker was has a problem with the housing, and then these people, some of these people were for weeks in arrest, in preventive arrest, because there was unrest in this housing. So preventively, you can do a lot of things. You can arrest people. You can search them. Could be dangerous. You don't look what's happening. You don't look have they done anything. They are just looking forward what could happen. In sometimes it can be reviewed by the court. But if it's an imminent danger, it's very difficult to prove that you are not dangerous. It's a very flexible law which allows a lot to the authorities. And it's not only in Bavaria, but also other lands that you see here on the slide are also trying to do the same thing. So if one land has done it, others are following.
Deutlich mehr Eingriffsbefugnisse für die Polizei.
There are much more possibilities for the police to take measures. And you see, we are in a security situation which is not very dangerous. We think we have a very good, secure environment in Germany. So nobody is roaming the streets with weapons. We have even criminal figures are going down. So basically this hysteria is not needed. We have enough legal basis for act against offenses. But the mood now is very hysteric in this field. In Berlin, there is also something happening. In Berlin?
Allgemeinverfügung gesucht, habe ich gesehen, es gibt in Frankfurt und so weiter.
Jetzt but also in Frankfurt, do they do it?
Also in Berlin, nochmal kurz als sozusagen Erläuterung, the, hat die Bundespolizei...
There is a ban of dangerous tools in railway stations and in railways, just as a regulation. It's a single regulation.
Sachverhalten machen, dann ist das kein Gesetz, sondern ist das eine.
So it's not a law, it's a simple regulation, but a general regulation. Of course, they didn't do it in on their own. Of course, it was allowed. So the legal base in the public transport, there are so many people with dangerous weapons or different tools, which could be dangerous. So this is something they took from the penal law. It's the dangerous tool. So it's not dangerous in itself. It is dangerous when it is used in a certain manner. And of course, everything can be used. You can even have a laptop. If you have a very good laptop, you can bash somebody with a laptop. So it's a very dangerous tool that can be forbidden. Bottles or canes. So basically, anything can be a dangerous tool, and Swiss Army knife, of course, also. Now, is it dangerous because it could be used? If this person has this kind of tool, then of course this could be very dangerous.
Here we see Andreas Burg from the CCC, and he charged together with us, the GFF, because he has to pay 250 euros because he... Yeah, you see, he is a typical middle European. And maybe this could be even more dangerous for people who don't look normal, like, at least for the police officer. And maybe this person has a knife with them. They can stop and search, stop and frisk, like in America. Is this against civil rights? It actually is. Well, there should
be.
So, you not only ask a suspect person, but you can ask her without any cause. So, in Berlin, people have not only dangerous tools, they have sometimes also some drugs with them, and then they find. You find it incidentally, and then you can use this. So this was now the situation, and we say liberty is for everybody, freedom is for everybody. It's also discrimination is also an issue.
Anlasslose Durchsuchung.
We are now supporting a journalist against the TV who is acting against the gender pay gap. She wants to have equal pay between men and women. So the gender gap is 21% in Germany, which is incredible. In March, there is the Equal Pay Day, So basically, until March, the women are working without pay because they earn so much less. Of course, there are factors you have to calculate because they are working part-time or they are working longer. But still, there is 6% which cannot be explained as a gap between women and men, even with equal formal education, equal situation. This journalist is a very well-known and very successful journalist. She found out that people who did the same thing, the men in the same office, had much more pay. And at a certain point, even people who was here a shorter time has less experience than her was paid better. So she asked, could this be discrimination? She tried to discuss with her employer, with the ZDF. ZDF was not very responsive. So she made a complaint for the money. This is a classical structural issue. So you have to find one person who is ready to act against her actual employer, which needs some courage. Then you have Article 219A of the Penal Code, Criminal Code. It punishes information, very neutral information about legal abortion can be punished, which is incredible because the abortion itself is absolutely legal. But the assumption is that this information is basically hidden marketing.
And
that's why it is punishable. Christina Händel, a doctor from Gießen was convicted just because she told that she was basically ready to make abortions. And this is a case that we are now going through the courts. There is no marketing, there is no advertisement. So it's absolutely not the case. But this is of course marketing is not allowed, but neutral information is absolutely a different story and should be absolutely okay. So this was
This was a potpourri, very variable, of what was happening. One thing they have in common, they are all from this house, you see there, the German parliament. In general, this is fails from the German government, for parts also from the federal state. And it's very important that you protest, that you call the government. There are many topics that aren't heard in the government. And for parts, people aren't interested in that. And even if you talk to them, sometimes tell you they aren't interested. And that's a point where sometimes political work comes to its border to its limits.
ACLU,
the American Liberal Union, ACLU, is one of our big big idols. They have a problem with a president who is hurting civil rights constantly. There was, for example, a ban of people coming to the country. There weren't even legal help allowed on the airports, and this was a problem with the civil rights and the human rights, and we need fighters who defend them. You've spoken about this also when you've been in the USA with ACLU and EFF. Yes.
Als Verein, wir haben dann den Launch gemacht 2016.
That's when we started GFF. We founded the association in 2015. Our strategy is actually trying to ask how does it work to work together with NGOs to.
Besonders gut können ist klagen, aber zum
Beispiel, yeah, what we can do very good is charging. We like to work together with others,
and yeah,
we bring the juristic measures. So what is the aim?
Das Ziel ist eben die Sicherung, die Verbesserung der Grund- und menschenrechtlichen Standards.
So we want to secure and to better the civil and the human rights standards. And beneath the political instruments, we are using the strategic process management. We will tell something about it. You see us two, and there are two other people, also legal specialists, which are on our board. Malte Spitz is known because in 2011 she brought the telecom before court because they were giving data to the police. And he wanted to know which data the telecom has collected and given to, for example, the police or secret service. And you can use a lot. So these are about 30 fixed members in the circle of trust. So this is the people who is really working. And we have 2,400 sponsoring members who are supporting us. Our team has grown. So there is not only the board who is volunteering, but we have also paid employees. We have a secretary general. We have litigator, fundraiser, communications. We have legal help and interns.
Juristen und Juristinnen im Haus, im Legal Team, Fundraising, Kommunikation und so weiter. Wir bilden natürlich auch aus, klar, Ehrensache.
So we also forming them.
Seht ihr zum Beispiel uns am Stand, ja, Referendarin.
You can meet them on our stand in the Congress here. About Freedom Space, you can find us. So come along, and we're happy to show you around. Yeah. We have nice merchandising material you could get. And our legal helps and interns are waiting there for you. How are we financed?
Ja, wir sagen immer, wir sind so eine Kriegskasse für die Grundrechte.
So. We are a treasury for the civil rights. So, we have the money ready. We are having an infrastructure. Everything is ready. And this is of course costs a lot of money. For example, to work with lawyers and so on. So donations are very important. And the sponsoring members are very important. So they promise to pay a certain amount every year, like a subscription. You see, it's sustainable, it's independence, and it's also you can also plan the income. Because of course we have a lot of costs running. So if we know how much money we get from our sponsoring members, then of course it helps a lot to be independent. 90 euros a year, you can of course pay also more. So there's a beer for freedom per month, so this is a reasonable amount.
Vor allem an unsere vielen Fördermitglieder. Wir haben nämlich gehört, es sind ganz viele schon am Stand vorbei.
We have a lot of our sponsoring members who came along on the stand on the CCC. So it's very nice. Give them an applause. And we are also financed by partnerships. You see some partners we are working together. Compact, CCC, Netzpolitik.
Noch keine Fördermitglieder hat und keine
just in the moment where we were starting, when we had quite a few sponsoring members, it was very important to have this institutional support to finance the complaints we want to file before the courts. Now, what is strategic process management?
Strategische Prozessführung, was ist das eigentlich? Das heißt natürlich strategisch.
So basically, there is a long-time strategy for civil and human rights. We have specific categories where we are working. So we are choosing very carefully the cases. We are trying not single cases, but to find the right plaintiff who will be who has the biggest chances to win the plea. We have now a dozen of cases who are pending. So some cases are developing, others are in a special situation. So, but we have done quite a lot. So we want to have as much as possible complaints, but we have to find the right one, also to have the right partners. Of course, we are making some work along, so press work, we are working on the internet, we are social media, so we show it also in the public, we are also on conferences, like here today. So it's very, very difficult with all this legal stuff, so it's very important that we are communicating. So you show a fail that I try to put the folder into the post box of the constitutional court, but it didn't fit. But at the end, I could file it in the right time, so it was okay. So in Karlsruhe, you can sometimes make the complaint directly, but in other cases, you have to go through all the instances, and sometimes you have also to go to different kind of courts. So then sometimes you need also an amicus brief, which means that there are supporting acts for you. So we have acted against the secret service law. This is now very important, and we are working on it. That's one of the focal point. We have constitutional complaints on national level. And also in the Länder, in Bavaria, and in Baden-Württemberg, and we are preparing some complaints in other Länders. So we try to reach all police laws in all the Länders. We are trying to harden their laws. Saxonia is missing, and Brandenburg is also. So we are also supporting complaints against where transparency is not given. We are cooperating with Frag den Staat, Ask the State, which is a special project. And we have a project on transparency complaints. So if the transparency is not given, you can ask us, and then we will try to look if we make a complaint. And for example, we had a success. We wanted to have the protocols of the federal cabinet. So in some parts it was successful, very astonishing for us. Of course, they said that it was a security issue, but of course there are a lot of some parts. For example, the participants of the cabinet meetings were published for Markus Beckedahl. So it was basically regarding one specific cabinet decision, and there were different people working on the lobbying side and on the government, and he wanted to show that there was some kind of collusion. And we are preparing some other cases. I already talked about the police laws. Then, for example, also for sponsoring of research, transparency.
Yeah.
Also, the census law is quite an urgent thing. The law passed in November, but the data transfer I showed before is already planned for January. So you have to act very, very quickly, and you have to be prepared, and that's what we are, and that's why we need also the money to help this preparedness. And of course, freedom needs fighters. Thank you. Have you questions?
Ich mache die Frage, du die Antworten, oder? Ist okay?
Ja, vielen Dank, Nora Markhardt und Ulf Burmeier.
Thanks.
Ja, wir haben Zeit für Fragen.
We have now some time for questions. I see already the first person on the mic.
Ja, hi. Vielen Dank für eure Arbeit.
Thanks for this work.
Ihr seid die Gesellschaft für Freiheitsrechte und ihr habt...
You are the GFF. And you said that for you, ACLU is an example. So it is known that they have also represented some people who are not very good, and would you fight for everybody, even for extreme groups?
That didn't occur till now. That would depend on the case. You said, yes, the ACLU, for example, helps Nazis. In Germany, the law would be a little different. We think the most important thing is areas where people can't issue their rights because they are somehow excluded. And I don't think that isn't really a topic where we would give our resources into, because we have problems with the civil rights, and that's more basic.
Dann würden wir halt einfach versuchen, Klägerinnen und Kläger zu finden, die das Problem vielleicht so ein bisschen besser und so ein bisschen weniger kontrovers.
If there is a difficult plaintiff, we would try to find someone, a better plaintiff with the same problem. So yeah, we would try to find a pretty good plaintiff.
Ja, es gibt ja noch Millionen Zuschauer zu Hause vor.
There are millions of people who are in the internet watching us.
Und zwar, wie beurteilt die GFF den in diesem Jahr vollzogenen zweiten einmaligen Datenabgleich aller Einwohnermeldebehörden mit dem Beitragsservice in Köln?
How is the GFF judging the comparison of the central data of people with the TV fees?
Actually, I really looked into this case, also from my work. I can't say too much about this, because the the Constitutional Court's decisions aren't really similar about this. And yeah, it's a difficult question. Karlsruhe already has spoken. I see it critical, but there we couldn't use our resources in a good sense.
Mikrofon 1.
Jetzt gab es letztens bei der Lage der Nation einen Beitrag zu der Gemeinnützigkeit der deutschen Umwelthilfe.
There was a discussion about the tax exemption for Umwelthilfe. Now, how is the tax exemption for you?
Yes, you don't have to pay taxes. We are actually
exempted.
Ja, hallo, erstmal danke für den Vortrag.
Thanks for the talk.
Klagt ihr auch gegen die EU-Verordnung? Und wenn nicht, gibt es eine Organisation wie eure auch auf Europaebene?
Are you also complaining against EU?
EU-Verordnungen kann man klagen, in der Tat.
You can do something about EU laws that would need different courts. Of course, if this is a problem in Germany, we are in place for that. Even concretely, we are preparing something against the storage of data of people who fly. Passengers.
Ja, wir haben noch ein paar Fragen aus dem Internet.
We have some other questions from the internet.
Ja, das Wort Gefährder suggeriert Gefahr. Sollte man daher statt Präventivgewahrsam für Gefährder lieber verfahrenslose Inhaftierung von Unbescholtenen oder eine ähnliche Formulierung verwenden?
Was ist?
Ja, klar. Natürlich, ja. Natürlich ist das Neusprech. Ja? Also falls der ein oder andere...
The word offender is a new word.
Karl Biermann mit dabei. Also machen wir Karl Biermann.
Well, Karl Biermann does also presentations about these new languages, about the how these words are searched, and the question is if these people are really dangerous, and I don't think.
Würden Sie auch bei einer Aktion wie bei den Hausdurchsuchungen der Zwiebel bei den Zwiebelfreunden Unterstützung leisten?
Would you also support it if there is a search with the Tor network people?
We actually talked about the Friedel, this squat house in Berlin, and we were in a good cooperation with them.
Aber das, da waren wir quasi dran, ja, aber die, ja, wie gesagt.
Yeah, we were with them, but, yeah, we nearly finished, but sometimes it's good to win. Good when the state works.
Ja, ich wollte mal fragen, wie das mit den Ambitionen und der Erfüllung davon aussieht. Also wie viel Sachen würdet ihr gerne machen? Wie kommt ihr gewissermaßen
dabei hinterher? What is your ambition? How many things would you like to do? There are new topics coming up, and there are, of course, old topics still active. Is money a constraint?
Thanks that you talk about the money. That's an important topic. In February, there a third woman will join our legal team. There are many problems that we are working more than we actually could. We are on the limit of what we can reach. We want to reach a level where we can take all the important cases and still have a little bit of air so that organizational structures can establish. Everything that is costing money, we need time for that. The cases are part of what an organization like ours needs.
Der Kongress des CCC, wir haben selbstverständlich überhaupt keine Cloud-Dienste.
Congress,
fast alles ist open source.
Yeah, much of what we do is open source. All the servers are working on Linux. We have our own VPNs, our own digital infrastructure. We are completely independent from IT companies in that part. They have to kick in our door if they want to find out something about us. And To add some numbers, we have about 200-400 members who are paying. That's more, we would need about 5,000 paying members to actually reach the aims we want to. And we would need about 15 to 20 people working for us to actually do everything what we want to. And I hope, in Germany, I think we're a really good organization.
Vielleicht die restlichen Fragen, die jetzt noch sind, später am Stand von
Maybe the questions who are left, you can post at the stand from them. Thanks, Nora and Ulf.